think this was where we left off on Friday. We were talking about how to measure body composition using skin folds and then doing something called bioelectrical impedance. Okay, so we'll start with kind of picking up with the skin folds, and then we'll move into a couple of other things, and at the end we'll talk a little bit about how do we know the relationship between body composition and some health outcomes. Okay, so what I want to do as we move our way through this is when we measure skin folds, okay, what you're going to do is, as we had looked at the other day, is we pinch, pull the skin away, we pinch, we measure the thickness of, excuse me, of subcutaneous fat. We use that amount of subcutaneous fat to estimate a body density, and then we use the body density to estimate your percent body composition, okay? So when we do skin folds, and for a while, this was kind of the second best way for us to do things. If you were back in the 60s and 70s, and even somewhat up into the 80s. And to be honest, if you're a person that is well trained at taking skin folds, I can probably get estimates of body composition and percent fat and lean tissue that are not going to be that far off of what you would see from a person. Let these ladies in. Not that far off of what you would be able to see from doing underwater weighing or something. It's not going to be quite as accurate. Oh, okay. Can you guys see this? The little orange box says, "Please move this window away from the shared application." I'm going to pause sharing for a moment and let me see if I can. No. Don't know what's happening with this.
Is this the body composition notes or the health appraisal notes?
The body composition notes, Madison. Okay. Let me. I don't know why this is doing this. This is strange. All right, I'm gonna turn sharing back on. Okay, so hopefully that will have fixed our little extra box problem. So my apologies. So as I was saying, so when we do a skin fold, we're going to pinch and pull away, and we're going to use that estimate of body density from measuring these different subcutaneous fat sites to then try to see how much this is, how much percent body fat you have. So the reason that skin folds work is that somewhere between maybe 30 to 60% of all the lipid tissue in your body is contained as subcutaneous fat. And so it's going to be fat. Subcutaneous fat is fat that is immediately under your skin at various locations across your body. And so every location in the body is going to have differing amounts of subcutaneous fat. And people are going to tend to store subcutaneous fat differently among each person. Okay. And so if we can make enough measures at multiple sites all over your body, then we can get a reasonable estimate of what we think your total body fat percentage is going to be. And that's the general idea behind doing all of this. Okay. When we do skin folds, You either do a what's called a 3-site or a 7-site measurement. And so what that means is that you're going to pinch at 3 places or 7 places, okay? And when you do the 3 sites are all contained within the 7. In general, the more places that we can make a measurement, so the 7-site measurement tends to be more accurate than the 3-site measurement, okay? And so we'll kind of walk you through now, where do we make these measures? Why are these going to be the places that we do that? And then which of the 7 sites are the 3 sites? They're going to be different for men and women, okay? So 7-site estimations are the same in both men and women, all right? And so I will try on myself, at least on my upper body, a little bit. Do I have them? No, I don't have them in here, to show you where we are measuring. Okay, so one place that we measure is chest. So we measure here, we take a pinch kind of that runs between, if you make a 45 degree angle between the line of where your nipple is to the top of your armpit, we make a pinch here, okay? We make a tricep estimate, so we're getting chest, subcutaneous fat, some measure on our arm, okay? We have an abdominal site. I will not subject you guys to having to see where my abdominal site is, but the abdominal site is you find your belly button and we go just adjacent to your belly button, okay? We also make a measurement that is called subscapular, and that is going to be done. You have a person stand and put their arm behind their back, and then we measure on the back at the inferior angle of the scapula. So you're going right under where their scapula is. So we're getting sort of an upper back measurement of fat. A site that's called the supra-iliac, which is going to be taken at a diagonal measurement across the top of the iliac crest, okay? And so it's a little more to the front than where what people sometimes refer to as a love handle might be, but it's gonna be kind of right in that kind of front area right over your iliac crest. So again, we've got 2 estimates of how and where are you depositing subcutaneous fat in the abdominal region, okay? The mid-axillary region is over your ribs, right in here. And then we take a measurement on your thigh, right about at the midpoint between top of the patella and the head of the femur. So kind of right in the middle of your thigh, right over the top of where the rectus femoris muscle is going to be. And so you measure all of these sites. We add up the total amount of subcutaneous fat thickness in millimeters at all of these sites. And we plug that into a couple of different equations. One is called the Jackson-Pollock equation, which lets us calculate body density. There are different equations for men and for women, and it accounts for age as well, okay? For doing this, there are 7-side equations, and there are also 3-side equations. So in men, the subset of the 7 that we would use if we're just going to measure 3 are the chest, abdominal, and thigh. And then in women, we're going to use the triceps, the supra-iliac, and the thigh. These have been selected because these are places where men and women will tend to store fat somewhat differently. Okay. And so that's why those are going to be the 3 sites that we're going to use. Now, normally you get to practice all of this as part of our lab, but we will not be able to do that this time. I think all that I'm going to have you guys do is you're going to calculate BMI, and then you're going to try to measure a waist circumference, and we're going to use that to try to estimate some things. And then we'll just look at some older data from some of my previous classes. I'll assign everybody some data from there, and you can try to do some skin fold calculations to see how it works. Okay, so one of our other ways of calculating percent body fat is to use something called bioelectrical impedance. And this is a technique that looks very sophisticated, but is actually not very sophisticated. And of all of the things that we tend to use to estimate percent body composition, this is probably the least accurate, okay? If DEXA is the most accurate of the things that we can feasibly do, and then underwater weight and the bod pod, then skin folds. Usually with skin folds, we can get within 4 or 5% if you do it correctly. Then biological impedance is going to be the least accurate. The theory behind bioelectrical impedance is that the more muscle that you have in your body and the less adipose tissue you have, muscle has a lot of water in it. Water is a good conductor of electricity. The more adipose tissue you have, adipose tissue functions as an insulator. Fat does not transmit electricity very well or as well as water. And so what we know from this is that when you have you stand on a little platform like this, or we have you grab onto this device here on the bottom, and it's going to run this very, very mild, imperceptible, you don't ever feel it, run an electrical current up 1 foot through your body, and then it's going to come back out of the other foot. Or it's going to run it through into one hand, and then it's going to check it and see how long it takes it to be received in the other one. And so the theory being that the more impedance to flow you have, the slower that current moves through your body from 1 foot over to the next or from one hand to the next, the slower it moves, the more adipose tissue you have. And so then, based upon your age and a few, your height and your weight, it estimates limb length, and it does a few other things, some calculations in the background. It can then use the time that takes to estimate what your body composition is, what your percent fat is going to be. Looks very sophisticated. It's not particularly accurate. Bioelectrical impedance, if you are a person that has a lot of muscle and not very much fat, it tends to underestimate in you and make you quote unquote leaner than you actually are. If you are a person that is sort of morbidly obese and you have probably more adipose tissue than kind of an average or even slightly above average person has, then it tends to overestimate. It does reasonably well in the middle. If you're just kind of an average, normal person, then it can get probably within 4 or 5% accuracy. But if you're on either end, the bioelectrical impedance tends to either under or overestimate. Okay. All right. So if that's how we're going to calculate everything, that's how we're going to try to arrive at a percent body composition, We now need to get into this idea of, well, how do we take what we're going to learn and make some accounting for what is healthy, what is unhealthy, how does this play a role in combination with fitness or physical activity in sort of your risk of cardiovascular disease and diabetes and those things, okay? So the initial way of doing this is that we do everything not by body composition, but we do it by BMI. Okay. And so if you are a person whose BMI is greater than 25, but it's less than 30, so it goes from 25 to 29.9, then you have an excess body weight per your height in comparison to what we're thinking is a standard weight. That means you're overweight. Okay. If your BMI is over 30, then you are considered to be obese. And some people will make some classifications of, if you're between 30 and 35, then it's like obese 1, and 35 to 40 is obese 2, and over 40 is considered morbidly obese. But in general, the farther over 30 you are, then the greater your risk of overall mortality or cardiovascular disease or diabetes, and for some kinds of cancers, those risks are going to go up. okay? But there's real breakpoints at 25 and at 30, okay? The assumption behind using BMI to do this is that for the most part, in the vast majority of people, as we gain weight, we are gaining extra adipose tissue. You have excessive amounts of body fat rather than excessive amounts of lean tissue. As we talked about, BMI does not do a great job in very, very, very muscled up individuals. Okay, so in a lot of athletes or people that are bodybuilders or something like that. So if you're a person that has a lot of muscle, then your BMI is going to potentially erroneously classify you as being at an increased risk of dying from something. Okay, so that raises the question, how many people are going to be here? Okay, so as we had mentioned on like day two of class, about 70% to maybe 75 now percent of adults in the US are overweight by BMI. Okay, about 70% of people have a BMI over 25. If we look at people that are over the age of 40, it's even higher than that. Okay, it's even higher. So lots and lots of people are overweight by BMI. Okay, about a third of people. So this is going to capture in that 70% of people are at least overweight. About a third of all people in our population are going to be obese by BMI. And again, if we exclude folks that are college age from this, then those numbers may be as high as like 50%. So if you're looking at people that are, say, over 40, then obesity rates are going to go up even higher. So what I hope you take away from this is that simply by BMI, we have a lot of people that likely have excess weight, and that's going to put them at this markedly increased risk of contracting cardiovascular disease and diabetes, especially. Those are the two primary things. Okay. Additionally, if we look in children, okay, the prevalence in children of being overweight and being obese has also, in the data that you see here, are on obesity. The prevalence in children has also gone up a lot since about the year 1980. Okay, it used to be that we would only see a very, very small percentage of the population of either folks that were basically 18 or under. That were obese by BMI. That number has steadily risen. And when we get into the talking about diabetes, you guys will see that there used to be a scenario where type 2 diabetes almost never occurred in folks that were teenagers. Okay. And we're beginning to see type 2 diabetes in folks that are teenagers and that are college aged or even into their 20s. And that is mostly due to this excessive amounts of obesity that we're beginning to see in that population. Very sedentary, very obese, and that leads to type 2 diabetes. That's going to be the big issue with obesity. Okay, so if we look at, and these are some newer data, and they're state-by-state types of data. These are data that show the prevalence of self-reported obesity by state. Okay, so in states that are red, this was in 2018, so just a couple of years ago, it's greater than 35% of the population, of the adult population, is going to be obese. Orange is somewhere between 30 and 35%, and then the yellow is between 25 and 30. So we only have a couple of states, Colorado, Hawaii, and then I know Washington, D.C. is not really a state, but it is, you know, it's kind of its own entity where we have stuff that's under 25%. Okay. If you were to look at these corresponding data from, say, 30 or 40 years ago, the map would be mostly green or whatever is less than green. So this is a much more kind of recent finding. You will look at and see that it tends to be the highest in some of these states in the Southeast, And then if you were to look at where the obesity rates are going to be the highest, if we also then look at corresponding excess mortality rates and excess deaths from cardiovascular disease and the rates of diabetes, they're all going to be highest in the places that have the highest level of obesity, okay? So here are the prevalence of self-reported obesity among non-Hispanic white adults. So I bring this up and I'm going to show some of these data because there does seem to be some role of ethnicity as it relates to obesity, okay? Folks of African-American descent, okay, or African descent and Hispanic descent and Native American descent tend to have higher rates of obesity than what we would call sort of non-Hispanic whites or just sort of regular European, Caucasian Americans. And so you will note that there's less states that are in the kind of in the high red, okay? But states that tend to have less urban areas, that tend to be more rural and have higher non-Caucasian populations. So states like Mississippi and Louisiana, places that are going to have more African Americans, and then places like Nevada and Arizona and New Mexico. And California is kind of a strange thing. The population is so big and so much of it can be urban that it's a little different. But places that have some more rural areas like Nevada, Arizona, and New Mexico, but that also have larger Hispanic and Native American populations, and then Oklahoma that has its Native American population. We're a little on the we don't have quite as many African Americans or Hispanic Americans, but there's going to be a little bit of a difference, okay? And so in the African American community, in the Hispanic community, in the Native American community, obesity prevalence tends to be higher. Diabetes rates tend to be higher. Cardiovascular disease rates tend to be higher. And we don't necessarily think that a lot of this is purely a genetic thing. A lot of it is sort of sociocultural, related to socioeconomic status in general. People, regardless of ethnicity, that are lower on the socioeconomic status range tend to have higher rates of obesity. It's expensive to buy better food, to buy fruits and vegetables and lean meats like fish and steak and those kinds of things. It's more expensive. Going to having a gym membership and things are going to be more expensive. Additionally, if you look at education levels, obesity rates tend to be higher in, regardless again of ethnicity, in folks that are lower on the education spectrum as well. And so it's a, you know, we are still looking in America where, you know, less than half of the adult population has a college degree. I swear sometimes like less than a third have a college degree. And so if we kind of combine all of that stuff in, there's some sociocultural things that are going on with all of that that you guys will talk some about in lifestyle, you'll talk some about in health promotion program planning, and you'll talk about in community health some as well. It's a little bit beyond the scope of our class, okay? So just look, here's the Caucasian rates of obesity. Here's non-Hispanic Black adults, so African Americans. By all of that, we don't have any data in South Dakota and Idaho, mostly because their African American population is really, really small. But I want you guys to note that in general, okay, in lots and lots of states, then they're all over 35%. So they're in some places in the African American community, 50% or greater of the population is obese by BMI. And that leads to some poorer health outcomes in that population. Okay. Here are Hispanic Americans. Again, you will see very, very little green area in the places where there's not much green, Vermont, New Hampshire, and DC. They actually have a very small Hispanic population. But in the Hispanic community, there also tends to be these higher rates of obesity as well. So we just need to keep all of this in mind, okay? That obesity is a problem, but it's a complicated problem. It's not just simply, hey, don't eat at Chick-fil-A and go exercise. There are some sociocultural things about what is found to be attractive and kind of how jobs that are performed and socioeconomic status that are going to also play into all of this. Okay. So obesity is very, very difficult to completely explain. There is a strong genetic predisposition. Okay. If your parents are not obese by BMI, you have a much greater chance of also not being obese by BMI. If your parents are obese by BMI, then you're at a much greater risk of also being BMI, of having a higher BMI, regardless of what you eat, regardless of how active you are. Okay? So genetics plays a role. There are some physiological and psychological things that go into this. People that have suffered from emotional trauma, post-traumatic stress, abusive relationships, either as children or as adults, whatever it might be, tend to be at a greater risk of becoming obese. There are some hormonal conditions, especially as it relates to like thyroid hormones and things that are going to play there. And then there are cultural and familial factors. When I was at Ole Miss in Mississippi, one of our PhD students was doing a study where she was going into some of the smaller, more rural, almost predominantly African-American communities in the Mississippi River Delta. And they were doing like needs surveys and things, stuff that you guys will talk about in health promotion program planning. And they would have, especially African-American women, that would come in and talk about wanting, they needed to gain weight to be more physically attractive. And they did not have any understanding and had never been taught that potentially being obese could have poor health outcomes. They just thought that this was what the men tended to find more attractive. And so they would come into the doctor and ask them, what can I do so that I can gain weight, so that I can be more physically attractive? And so these ideas of kind of cultural ideas of what is an ideal weight and what is attractive, and those things are going to differ. They've differed throughout history. They differ in different kind of communities. And we just need to be aware of all of this. When you go and you talk to different communities, when you talk to different people, if you are a doctor or a physical therapist or a personal trainer, you're doing something, and we want to be cognizant of these things, right? Cognizant of things like this that may be considered bias on our own parts of how we were raised, kind of what our culture has been on all of this, that other people may not feel that way. We just have to try to present this information to them in a way that can be sort of encouraging to them and giving them the ideas of kind of what may be better health behaviors, but also being cognizant of that, you know, not everybody, you know, thinks that we need to look all kind of in the same way. Okay. Related to all of this, obviously, are going to be diet composition and physical inactivity. Across all communities, diet composition, people that tend to eat more, they eat more fast food, which are these very nutrient-dense, kind of a very nutrient-dense diet, very high in saturated fat, things that have been fried. That tends to be a larger percentage of the diet in folks that are lower on the socioeconomic status place, mostly because they're going to, that food is going to come cheaper, okay? And so you're going to eat these kinds of things because you get a lot of nutrients for a reduced price. As I said, salad and vegetables and fresh fruit. I went to Whole Foods this morning to buy some things for our daughter, and, you know, things like strawberries and blueberries and stuff like that that we try to give her are outrageously expensive. So, again, keep all of this in mind. Okay, so we've talked again about the health risk of overweight and obesity. Pretty much everything that we're going to get into from a chronic disease standpoint from here on out in class is going to at least be obliquely related and made worse by obesity. Okay, type 2 diabetes, okay, high blood pressure, risk for certain kinds of cancer, especially breast cancer and ovarian cancers. Different mood disorders, anxiety and depression tends to be higher in folks that are obese. Every kind of cardiovascular disease that we will talk about can be made worse by obesity. There's some issues in liver diseases, especially something called fatty liver disease, that is going to be related to type 2 diabetes, but is actually becoming more and more prevalent in children, that are all going to be related to being overweight and obese. So in a very general sense, if you are overweight, or especially if you are obese, you're at a higher risk of different chronic diseases, higher mortality rates, and decreased well-being in the midst of that. Okay, so we've talked about these kinds of things. This is a graph that is showing what we call BMI and excess mortality. And so it's graphing on the y-axis, the kind of excess rates of mortality. And then on the x-axis is the body mass index. And so what you can see here is people that fall on this, what we would call relatively normal body composition range. And you will note then that as we move into this overweight category, which is here, that risk goes up a little bit, not a huge amount, but a little bit. And then we get into kind of up to about 35, we call this moderate risk, or even up to 40, it's going to be kind of this high risk. But you can see that as BMI increases, there is this somewhat exponential increase in rates of excess mortality. Okay. And so these are the data that we use to inform why we cut off the BMI at the particular levels that we're going to. Okay. That's how we've arrived at that 25 is overweight, 30 is obese. These are the places where we're going to begin to see increases in excess mortality. Okay, so I want to provide a little bit of light at the end of the tunnel for all of this, though. Okay, and so these are some very, very famous data that were published in the late 90s. And what it's looking at is this is the relative risk of dying excessively or early from anything. And these are data from, they're actually body composition data. They're not based upon BMI. But there are people that are considered lean by body composition, kind of normal or average by body composition, and then obese by body composition. And the red bars indicate folks that had relatively higher levels of VO2 max, cardiorespiratory fitness. And then the yellow bars are folks that were considered to be unfit by VO2 max. So if you're red, if you're over your age predicted kind of normal values or average values, okay, you're fit. You're kind of over the outside of the 50th percentile. If you're unfit, you are under the 50th percentile. And so what I want you all to look at, though, is that if you can be active enough and you can raise your VO2 max, which everybody can do, regardless of your body composition, then fitness, the red bars are all relatively the same, right? Fitness seems to trump the idea of what we would sometimes refer to as fatness. So being obese is not as bad, okay, if you are also have some level of cardiorespiratory fitness. So regardless of what you weigh, regardless of how much percent body fat you have, if you are active, if you train to some extent and you can raise your VO2 max, then you can avoid a lot of the negative effects of obesity. Okay. You can avoid a lot of the effects, negative effects of obesity simply by being more active and being more fit. Okay. Okay. So we're going to finish off today talking a little bit about body weight regulation. So how do we get into trouble from increasing weight, increasing fatness, and those kinds of things? So I'm going to present this in a probably somewhat oversimplified manner. This is one of those things where it's a complicated concept, and people in the scientific community argue with each other a lot about what controls body weight regulation, what's the role of exercise, what's the role of diet, in a lot of different ways, and especially what is the role of your diet composition in this, okay? I'm gonna present this in a relatively oversimplified manner, all right? I'm happy to have a more in-depth conversation with any of you either before next class or after class today if you care about this, okay? At its most basic, okay, your body weight is regulated by your net energy balance. If you take in through eating more energy than your body is expending through its metabolic rate and any activities that you undertake every day, if you take in more than you expend and you do that over the course of many weeks or months, then you will gain weight. Okay? Depending upon what sorts of activities you are doing, then that's going to determine in some ways what the composition of that weight gain is going to be. If you are not expending very much energy from any kind of exercise, then the vast majority of the weight that you gain, when you consume excess calories, the body will try to store those calories as adipose tissue because it is worried about at some point in the future, maybe you won't get food on that particular day. Okay? If expenditure is higher than intake, so if your basal metabolic rate or your resting metabolic rate plus calories burned from any sort of physical activity, from work or exercise or whatever, if that number is bigger than what you are eating every day, then you will lose weight, okay? You will lose weight. And so both of those things will take a little bit of time, although you can lose weight relatively quickly. Especially in folks that are y'all's age, it takes a while for energy intake to go up. Okay. One of the issues that we see with intake is that, especially in places where food is much more readily available, then people are not very good at regulating appetite, and they will tend to eat more than they need to. Okay. Many of you probably heard of the idea of what is called the freshman 15, or people were also, at least in some of the people I follow on social media, talking about the COVID 15 or the pandemic 15, where you're at home and all you want to do is eat. But oftentimes people will go to school. You guys have a meal plan. You can go over to couch and get all you can eat, 3 meals a day, which is going to include pizza and fried chicken and Chick-fil-A and a whole bunch of other things that are really, really good. And so you tend to overeat. Okay. We know at its very basic that this energy balance concept works. If you eat more than you expend, you will eventually gain weight. If you eat less than you expend more than you intake, you will in fact lose weight. Okay. That's kind of the general gist of regulation. So, the very end of this, Dr. Pinku likes to talk about carbs and fats on all of this. When you're intaking energy, carbohydrates and proteins tend to have about 4 kcals per gram of whatever you're taking. So if you look on the back of any kind of food and it says, oh, it has 10 grams of carbs, then it's probably going to have about 40 calories from carbohydrates in there. Proteins are the same. Fats tend to have about 9 kcals per gram. So fat has more calories per weight than carbohydrates or proteins do. So if you eat things that are high in fat per the weight of that food, you're going to end up consuming more calories from all of that. Okay. Alcohol. So I don't know if any of you are 21 or not. If you are 21 and you have consumed alcohol, also I'm not naive enough to think there are some of you that are not 21 that have also at some point consumed alcohol. When you drink alcohol, all alcohol has about 7 grams per kcal or 7 kcals per gram as well. So there's more calories in alcohol than there are in carbohydrates and protein per weight. Just things to keep in mind. Okay. Dr. Pinku likes to have people do a calculation where if you drank a 12-ounce Heineken, then, you know, something that's 5% alcohol has so many grams of alcohol in it, a little bit of protein and some carbs. You can figure out how many kcals that you have to have. And then based upon your body weight, you can determine essentially how far do you have to walk or run to burn off the calories in one 12-ounce beer. Okay. We're not going to do that, but you can if you want to. It's probably easier to just look at the calorie content on one of those things. You know, if a beer says it has 95 calories, if it's a Michelob Ultra, or, you know, 100 some calories, if it's a Miller Lite or whatever, then just assume that 100 calories is a mile and you got to run that far for every one of those that you're going to drink. Okay. That's the general sense though. Typically when we eat more than what we need to, we're going to want to store that, and we're going to tend to store it as adipose tissue. If you are doing training as a part of that, especially resistance training, you will gain some fat, but you will also gain some muscle mass. The more fascinating part of things is when you're trying to lose weight. So if you're exercising in addition to maybe eating less than what you need in a particular day, when you lose weight, if you're just dieting, you will lose weight as you will lose fat and you will lose muscle. If you are resistance training or doing some kind of aerobic training and you're also dieting and you're eating less than you need, you tend to almost exclusively lose fat. You will tend to maintain some of your muscle mass. And so folks that are on a diet really need to pay attention to that as you lose muscle mass, you're also going to lose resting metabolic rate. So just some things to kind of be cognizant of as we do that. Okay. Questions about body composition. You guys will note that I did not present you with any sort of, I didn't present you with any kind of normative ranges as it relates to if we measure your body comp, if we know you have 22% body fat and you're a 21-year-old woman, is that normal? Is that underweight? Is that overweight? Is that obese? Like we don't have, that's because we don't have normative values. We have very, very little data on kind of the health consequences and what the ranges would need to be based upon actual measures of body composition. Okay, but you can, if we had made the measures in class, then typically normal for a woman is considered somewhere between 20 and maybe the kind of low 30s. Typical college age man is going to be maybe from the mid teens to the very low 20s is considered kind of average. And then obese in women is usually over 40. In men, it's oftentimes going to be maybe you're in the high 20s to over 30. Okay. So that's kind of where we are. Okay. Anybody have questions? Are you guys actually there, or am I just talking to black screens? Okay, Jordan's here. Okay. Judy, you have a question?
No, I don't have any questions. Thank
okay,
you,
well, your thing just lit up, and I thought, oh, did you say something? So, okay. All right, then we will go ahead and we'll take our break, and then we'll start talking about health appraisals. So I need to recording again. So we're going to move on from body composition now, and we're going to talk about something called health appraisal, okay? And so tomorrow I will post some screening forms that you guys are going to, So can you guys see my screen? Can you see where it says health appraisal? Because Zoom is telling me that my screen sharing is paused. Can you guys see this?
It's on Skinfold method.
It's on Skinfold. Okay. So resume share. I'm going to close that. Okay. I closed the shared window. Now I want to share screen. Okay. How about now?
Yes, it's up.
Okay. All right, so I'm going to give you guys some forms to fill out. We'll start with them tomorrow in class on a couple of things. But the real thing here and the purpose of all of this, and I'll try to go reasonably quickly with this, is just that for doing a health appraisal, we've spent all this time in class so far up until now talking about the benefits of exercise, right? Exercise is good for you. If you exercise, it reduces your risk of cardiovascular disease and all of these other things. There's a problem, though, okay? And it's going to seem counterintuitive. On its face, yes, exercise is good. But in some ways, every time you go and exercise or anyone goes and exercises, you actually take your life into your own hands. You increase during that bout of exercise your chances of having especially some type of negative cardiovascular event occur. So like having a heart attack, okay, go up dramatically during a bout of exercise compared to just sitting, okay, and not doing anything. So this kind of weird, this sort of weird idea that's going on that if you exercise a bunch, it's good for you. We have lots of data. It really is. But every time you do go exercise, you actually increase your risk of dying from a heart attack significantly. Now, that's a bit of hyperbole in some ways on my part, okay? Yes, your risk of dying is going to go up dramatically, but we need to look at what your risk of having a heart attack is sitting there versus what it is when you start exercising. And what you guys will see is that, especially in young, otherwise healthy individuals, also especially if you're a woman, then the chances are so small that it doesn't really kind of matter. It's not something you should probably worry too much about when you're going to do things. Okay? So, in general, exercise is good. More tends to be better. There is this dose response. The more often and the longer that you exercise, the more fit you're going to become and the better your health outcomes are going to be. Okay? But especially vigorous exercise, so running, okay? Doing any kind of like going to any kind of workout classes, right? Going to CrossFit. Vigorous exercise comes with these inherent cardiovascular risks, okay? So we're very worried about sudden cardiac arrest and a myocardial infarction or a heart attack. And so these two things tend to happen in people that have either diagnosed existing cardiovascular disease or pre-existing cardiovascular disease, or they have an undiagnosed form of cardiovascular disease, which is called silent cardiovascular disease. Okay, and we'll talk when we get into the cardiovascular disease stuff. We may do that, probably start that tomorrow. Kind of what this idea of silent cardiovascular disease is and why some people may have it and not know it more so. Okay, so one of the things that's going to happen, especially in folks that are at risk for cardiovascular disease, so men and older individuals, okay, then the higher the intensity of exercise, the heart has to work harder, and that's going to put more strain on the heart, and there's going to be this kind of chance of things, okay? So if we're worried about this, if we're worried that you may have a heart attack, or we're worried that you may have sudden cardiac arrest during a bout of exercise, what do we need to do about that? How can we make sure that you are as safe as possible to go out and go for a run today, or to go ride your bike today, or to go lift weights or something today? Okay. Well, the way that we do this is through what's called a health appraisal. And we have to ideally do this, ask you questions to see, are you at an increased risk? Okay. Before you start exercising. Once you've done something, it's kind of too late in some ways, okay? And so we need to understand then, when we do a health appraisal, what are the questions we need to be asking, okay? If I want to know if Corey is at an increased risk of having a heart attack during a bout of running, then there are certain questions that I need to ask her, okay? They're going to relate to, does she have cardiovascular disease? Does she have risk factors for cardiovascular disease? There are some things that we know that are going to put you at a higher risk or that are going to put you at a lower risk. And so we want to evaluate this before you start. If we decide, based upon your responses to those questions, that you may be at an elevated risk, okay, then we can send you off to a doctor, have a doctor potentially run some additional tests on you. They can put an EKG on. They can do a stress test. They can assess truly how at risk are you. And then based upon the findings of those, they may put you on medication. They may say you can do this kind of exercise, but not other kinds of exercises. So we can adjust everything accordingly based upon that sort of the results of those physician-based tests. Okay. But for our purposes, for class, we just want to know what questionnaires do we use, what questions do we ask, and then based upon people's answers to all of that, how are we going to assess your particular level of risk, okay? So we are, by doing a health appraisal, okay, and I should probably say this now, there will be a question on the test that will say, who of these people needs to have a pre-exercise health appraisal performed on them? And the answer is everyone, okay? Everyone needs to have pre-exercise health appraisal screening performed. I don't care if you're the world record holder in the marathon. If you're going to come into my lab and we're going to have you run or we're going to have you lift weights, we're going to do anything, we're going to screen you, okay? And part of that is this idea of what I tell my grad students is it's this idea of cover your own ass, okay? We need to know. I don't care how much you normally exercise. I'm going to go out of my way and check and make sure that everything within my power to keep you safe, if you're doing something under my watch, can and will be done, okay? Because there may be a lot of people that exercise a bunch, but they may still have these underlying risk factors, and they may not know it. There may be some benefit to having them go to their doctor and get checked out for a couple of things, okay? So when we do pre-exercise health appraisal, when we do pre-exercise screening, we are hoping to identify potential medical problems, right? Have you previously had a heart attack? Have you previously had a stroke? Do you have a known cardiovascular, metabolic, or pulmonary disease of some kind? Okay. Do you have diabetes? Have you had a heart attack? Do you have emphysema or COPD or something? Okay. Do you have a medical problem that could put you at a higher risk of there being some kind of adverse cardiovascular reaction during exercise? Okay. In the absence of that, let's say you don't have those things, okay? We want to look then, do you have any risk factors or what we call signs or symptoms of these particular diseases, okay? Do you have a characteristic or do you engage in a behavior that may put you at a higher risk of something? You don't have the disease, but do you engage in a behavior or do you have a family history? Okay. Do you smoke? Are you obese? Okay. Do you have high LDL cholesterol levels? Are you inactive? There may be these lifestyle behavior things that are going to make it more likely that if you have a certain number of these, you're also going to be at a higher risk of having a heart attack during exercise. Okay. There are also things called signs and symptoms that are going to be indicative. Maybe you've not been diagnosed with, you've not been diagnosed with COPD, but you experience shortness of breath when you exercise or when you walk, okay? You get dizzy when you walk or you get dizzy when you run, okay? There's some very distinct, what we call signs and symptoms that are indicative of underlying health problems, okay? And so based upon which of these you tell us you do or don't experience or these behaviors in which you do or don't engage, we can make some determinations as to your level of risk and how safe it may be for you to do certain things. In the absence of all of those things, we can also use the results of your fitness test. So we can look at your 1RM or we can look at what your predicted VO2 max is going to be. And based upon that, we can make some general assessments, okay? Okay, so when we look at evaluating your health status, okay, what's the purpose of this? From a person who wants to prescribe exercise to another individual, there's this nice mnemonic called Mr. Please, okay? And so what we want to do with this is we want to do a medical history. We want to do a risk factor assessment. We want to look at your prescribed medications that you're currently taking. We want to look at what your current level of physical activity is. Use the responses to those to establish the need for physician consent to have you either get exercise tested with us or to start a program. Okay. Once we have gotten consent from a physician, if we need it, then we have you do your fitness test. We assess your 1RM. We assess how many push-ups you can do. We assess your VO2 max. we can then use those results to set up and prescribe exercise, and that will allow us at some point later to then retest and evaluate any changes in your fitness level. Okay, so we're wanting to do these first four things. This is part of the health appraisal. This is part of our pre-exercise screening. And we're going to establish then, do you need physician's consent to do whatever our exercise program is going to be? Okay. And so that will be the stuff that we will kind of start talking about in the next few slides. Okay. And all I'm going to do today is I'm going to introduce, and we'll go through the first of our screening questionnaires, and then we'll save the second one for starting tomorrow. Okay. We're going to go over two different screening questionnaires. Okay. One is called the PAR-Q. It stands for the Physical Activity Readiness Questionnaire. And the PAR-Q is very short. It's very, very short. It's going to have only 7 questions on it, and people provide a yes or a no answer to those 7 questions. Okay, and the PAR-Q was developed in Canada, and it is mostly useful for having people do light to moderate intensity only activities. So this is good for maybe some light intensity weightlifting and then stuff up to kind of brisk walking. It's really not detailed enough for us to make some determinations about if you're going to start running or jogging or doing cycling or, you know, some kind of exercise class, okay? Although at a lot of places, they will only, like if you went over to the HUF, you will mostly only do the PAR-Q. I think when I went and signed up at Orange Theory to take stuff, I only did the PAR-Q. And I tried not to be that guy and to tell them that they need to do more in-depth screening, because I was going to be fine, but I see a lot of the other people that are in there. There's likely some of them that needed physician's consent. Okay. Our second form is something from the American Heart Association, which is the AHA, and the American College of Sports Medicine, or the ACSM, and it's called the Health Screening Questionnaire. And the Health Screening Questionnaire is going to get at all of the same information that's covered in the PAR-Q, but it's also going to ask you some more detailed questions. It's going to be much more detailed about your medical history, your current medication use, okay, and do you experience signs and symptoms of these diseases during exercise? It's going to ask you also about some risk factor things that we'll get into tomorrow. It's a several page long questionnaire. It's much, much more in depth. Okay. So if we have our druthers, we want people to fill out the HSQ, the health screening questionnaire, because it gives us a much, much, much better sense of what their level of risk is going to be. Okay. So other things to keep in mind, you guys are going to do this for me, okay? I also very often will ask people as an assignment in class to go off and have their friends fill these out, and we will do risk stratification on your friends. Because of COVID and the interest of everything, you're not going to do stuff with other people. But you do need to understand that everything that we collect on these pre-screening questionnaires, okay, is considered protected health information. This is stuff that is protected under HIPAA, okay? And so whether it's just how active you are, do you have a diagnosed cardiovascular disease, do you get dizzy, what medications do you take, okay? Do you have a family history of cardiovascular disease? All of this stuff is considered protected under HIPAA, which just simply means that you get this information. You can't share it with other people, okay? You can't share it with other people. It is of the utmost importance that we make this known to the people that we are assessing, because we want them to feel as comfortable, okay, and have them be as honest as possible when they fill this out for us. We need them. We need them to be honest, okay, so we can keep them safe. And that means we may learn things about people that we know or that are our friends, you know, as being a researcher. I've learned all sorts of things when we have folks that come in that are other graduate students or that are other faculty that come in and fill out stuff as part of our lab. Because typically what happens if you're you go to participate in a study with one of my students, then they will bring me the your responses, and I will look over them as well. So, like, you know, we ask about recreational drug use. We want to know who smokes marijuana, okay, or who eats edibles, who does cocaine, who does methamphetamines, okay? Do people do heroin? Are you taking any sort of prescription medication for you? You name the medication, I've probably seen someone that is taking it for a chronic, kind of a chronic condition. Things in many ways as innocuous as birth control and stuff for anxiety and depression, but like we've seen people that take medication for HIV AIDS, for herpes is a more common one than you guys might think, okay? You name it, we see folks that come in with it, and we can't share that information. We have to hold it confidential, but a lot of those medications can raise the risk on things. So I will ask you guys to fill out these forms for me. I want you to be as honest as you can about all of this, but just know that when you turn these things in, that I cannot and will not share that information with anyone. You will get your grade for having done it, and then all of it gets deleted immediately. Okay. In addition to that, results on fitness tests. So one rep max and VO2 max and the number of push-ups that you, things you guys turned in for lab one that you will turn in from lab two is also considered protected health information. Okay. That's my HIPAA spiel. There's been a big deal now about whether or not if you say that you can't wear a mask in places that are requiring them because you have a health condition, if people can ask you what that health condition is and whether or not that's protected under HIPAA. I don't think in sort of private settings that people can, if you, they say you have to wear a mask, that you can say, oh, well, I have a health condition where I can't wear the mask, so will you let me in? I think they still have the right to kind of to kick you out of places. So that's also my plug. Please just wear a mask. Y'all are in the age group that has the highest rate of increase in COVID cases. And while it may not affect you guys, if you all come into contact with folks that are my age or your parents or your grandparents or somebody's people, then we're gonna end up spreading things back around. Okay. This is the PAR-Q. The questionnaire looks like this. Okay. As I said, 7 questions. I will share this version of the form with you. There's actually a new version that came out a couple of years ago. It asked the same questions, but the form looks a little bit different. So if you've been in the study in our department this last year, you may have done this, but on a slightly different looking form. But it has these 7 questions. You give a yes or a no answer. Okay. If you answer yes to any of these questions, then it's like Monopoly, do not pass, go, right? If you answer yes to any of them, then you must go to your doctor. And we must have written consent from your doctor that it is safe for us to exercise you. It does not matter what that exercise is. It can be walking, okay? It can be lifting 5-pound dumbbells, does not matter. If you answer yes, we send you to your physician to get clearance, okay? Better safe than sorry. So let's look at these 7 questions here at the very last thing we will do today, and kind of get at what are these questions asking? Why are these the questions that are being asked, okay? So the first question is, has your doctor ever said that you have a heart condition and that you should only do physical activity recommended by a doctor, okay? This is getting at, do you have a diagnosed cardiovascular disease that could be made worse by increasing the level of physical activity, okay? Number 2, do you feel pain in your chest when you do physical activity? Okay. Does anybody know what we call the pain that tends to be associated with people having heart attack? It's pain that tends to be on the left side of the body, neck, shoulder, down in your arm here. Does anybody know what that kind of pain is called?
Could you say again where it was? I wasn't listening.
It very often is in your left shoulder, in the upper part of your left arm. It may radiate up into the left side of your neck. Anybody? Nobody knows?
I don't know.
Nobody knows. Nobody wants to wager a guess. Have you guys heard of something called angina?
Chest
pain. That's right. Angina pain is chest pain, although it doesn't really, your heart does not in and of itself have, does not have nociceptive fibers, so your heart cannot feel pain, physical pain, not like emotional pain, right? And so what it does is it borrows the nociceptors of some surrounding tissues. And so when you get a lack of blood flow going to the heart, it's part of a heart attack, then you tend to get the pain in this area, okay? That's the chest pain that the thing is asking about. It's not just like, I run, I'm out of shape, I don't like it, like it's hard for me to, you know, I'm having a hard time breathing, this kind of hurts or something. It's angina pain, okay? It then says, in the past month, have you had chest pain when you were not doing physical activity? If you experience angina pain when you're not undergoing exertion of any kind, then you need to go to the doctor, like, immediately, okay? It asks about, do you lose your balance because of dizziness, or do you ever lose consciousness? Like, do you faint or pass out, okay? These are what we would call signs or symptoms of an underlying cardiovascular condition. Chest pain, okay, and dizziness or loss of consciousness are signs and symptoms, okay? If you experience those symptoms when you are not undergoing exertion, then that's a very, very, very big red flag, okay? Do you have a bone or joint problem that could be made worse by changing your physical activity, right? Do you have something that a doctor has told you, don't do this, it's going to make your bad knee worse? Is your doctor currently prescribing drugs for blood pressure or a heart condition, okay? And then do you know of any other reason why you should not do physical activity? I get lots of sarcastic responses on number 7, like, yeah, I just don't like it, it sucks. That's not a particularly good reason, but is there something else that may be going on? So this is asking, in essence, do you have cardiovascular, have you been diagnosed with cardiovascular disease? Do you experience any signs and symptoms of cardiovascular disease? Are you on a medication for something like that? Or do you have a bone or joint disorder that could be made worse, okay? So if you answer no to all of those, then we think it is reasonably safe for you to undergo light and moderate intensity activity. All right. So we're right at about 12:30, so we will go ahead and we'll call a stop here, okay? So I'm going to...